I was born in Providence, Rhode Island, December 1st, 1920. And we lived in Rhode Island, and so that's where my home was for quite a few years.
So was it kind of an urban upbringing in a city?
No, it was not. I lived on a point of land that stuck out in Narragansett Bay. And did a lot of sailing and things like that. And it was a nice place to live, very nice, outside the city.
What did you do for fun in your off time?
Did a lot of sailing. Yes, I lived out there.
Did you have a boat then?
Yes, I had a small boat that went like the wind, and used to just a big sailing skiff. But it used to plane in the right type of wind, and it was very nice. It was a nice boat, yes. It lasted up until 1938, when the 38 hurricane went up through Rhode Island, and I was out boating at the time, but not in that boat. My father and my uncle owned about a 30-foot yawl, and I was out in that alone at the time. I was supposed to be doing some work on the boat, and nobody knew the hurricane was coming. And so it blew so hard that it pulled a 200-pound mushroom across the bottom, and was drifting down under some rocks, a rocky point. So there was so much pull on the line coming up around the hawser that I had to take a knife out and cut the line. I drifted around the point, had to go sideways to the wind with no mast, no sails up, and laid the mast out in the water several times, and sat up on the edge of the boat, yelling, "Come up, come up, come up." I couldn't see 20 feet in any direction, except when I got out farther, the waves were coming up behind me about 30 degrees up in the air. So I was quite familiar with the bay, so I headed a heading, and I ran it up against a beach area, because the rest of the area was all rocks and so forth. Ran it aground, and unfortunately I have been doing something with a little dinghy, and everything but I had my pants on, but I didn't have any shoes or socks on, and I walked into Providence, Rhode Island, about 3 miles, and I walked about 5 miles home, and I got home just about sunrise. All this started about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. It was an exciting time. I did dumb things when I was completely soaking wet, and I went over a bridge that was underwater. The water was up to a little above my waist. I took my wallet out so it wouldn't get wet. I was barefooted.
But you wanted to get home.
I wanted to get home. When I walked through the middle of Providence, a little above Providence, there's a road that's a little higher there, and the buses were all underwater. And I walked through broken glass windows, and I could feel broken glass in my feet. And I never got a scratch, you know. So about 5 o'clock in the morning, I finally made it home. And so it was a busy time. I was, you know.
I'll bet your family was glad to see you.
Yes. My mother had passed away by then, but my uncle came down. He's the one that sent me out to the boat to do some work on it. And
how old were you about then?
Well, it was 38, so my birthday's in December, so I was 17, just out of high school. Yes, very nice, very nice.
Did you like being brought up in that area?
Yes, I enjoyed it very much.
What was it about that life in that area that, when you look back,
well,
you like so much?
My father worked for Sherwin-Williams Paint Company, and they used to move him to different places about every 4 years. So we started out in Providence, and we ended up in Worcester, and ended up in Springfield, and ended up back in Providence again. He worked in Providence for quite a while. You know, I had an old aunt that lived up in Barre, Massachusetts, about 45 miles, and that's really up in the boondocks. I spent quite a bit of time with her. So,
but it was a great childhood.
Huh?
Was it a great childhood?
Yes, yes, it was. My folks were very. I tried to behave myself, which I suppose is unusual nowadays.
Tell me what your situation was when Pearl Harbor was bombed.
Well, my father and my uncle owned a business, and it was a a braiding shop that they made decorative braid and braid for, during the war they made parachute straps. And I worked there a while. And we had no money. And actually, at the time, I had no hope whatsoever going to college. I graduated in 38. And so when the war, I took a couple of courses, one in photography and one in welding. There was a shipyard being built in the area. And I thought if I was going to be there and not in the service, I was going to get a paying job for a change instead of a quarter of an hour that we made, you know. I got a raise to 35 cents an hour. That was $14 a week. That was great pay, you know, which I gave seven to the house. But it was a nice thing. My mother died when I was about 15 or 16, and my father remarried, and she had a young daughter at the time, which we all got along fine. In fact, someone happened to mention to her, I happened to be there at the time, are you two getting along? She said, well, the only problem that we've had is I put her socks in the wrong drawer. But yeah, I had a good childhood. I really did.
And so what were you during, between those years between, you know, college and Pearl, excuse me, between those years of high school graduation and Pearl Harbor, were you involved in photography or doing?
Yes, I took wedding pictures and things like that, you know. Taking wedding pictures is kind of out of my physiognomy, because I like to talk to people and so forth. And, to take proper wedding pictures, you've got to be a monster. You've got to push people out of the way to get pictures of them throwing the flowers, and you've got to push people out of the way to do everything, you know. And I really didn't like that much of it, but if they wanted nice pictures, that's what you did.
Do you remember what your reaction was to Pearl Harbor, or what you thought of your reaction, what you thought at the time? Did it have any impact on you?
Well, at the time, I believe that I was working at the time, and we heard it over the radio. And at first, really, we didn't really believe that it was going to develop into the situation that it did develop into, actually, the whole world. And it was rather shocking because no one had any idea that there was such a thing possible, much less possible, much less probable. But it was astounding, is all I can say at the time. Well, I lived through what happened afterwards, yeah.
Talk about the process then under which you got into the service.
Yes.
I'm kind of curious why you didn't go into the Navy.
But that's a question. I knew everybody that I knew, that I spent time with, that I palled around with, went in the Navy. Except one friend who went into the paratroopers, who unfortunately never made it to the ground on D-Day. But everybody that I knew went into the Navy. And I really started out. Well, I really wanted to be a photographer in the service, and that's what really got me in. And then when I got down there, and they said, you can't be one because you don't have the 2 years. But they said, if you can pass the tests, we can take you. And that kind of set me off on the path that I did take, yeah. I'd done a little bit of flying, strictly illegal before that. My uncle had a flying license, and he used to take people different places. And he had a four-passenger plane, and I used to sit up in a co-pilot seat that he'd let me handle it on straight and levels flying, you know. But it was interesting. I always liked planes.
Were you drafted or did you enlist?
No, I enlisted.
Why did you enlist?
Because I wanted to get into where I wanted to get in.
Why did you feel like that? I mean,
well, because I had a lot of people that I knew, a lot of people that got drafted, and they went where they wanted them to go. I didn't want to go into the army. I didn't want to walk around. I was not much on exercise. So
you enlisted.
I enlisted.
Take us through that training period. You know, what happened after you enlisted?
Well, it took about two or three months from the time I got enlisted until I went up to Fort Dix. We took a train to Nashville, Tennessee, Smog Valley. Everybody in the whole All of the barracks were heated by coal stoves. The place was continually, and this was during the wintertime, was continually smoky. Everybody in the place had bronchitis or pneumonia, everything like that. It was an awful place, it really was. But that's where we took all the little tests, where you test your depth perception and all that, the little moving machinery with hand one way and depth perception with things this way. And so after that, I went to Americus, Georgia. And that was our instructors there were civilians. And that's how we flew the PT. And had an interesting thing happen there. We had a bad thunderstorm come up. And so I landed in, that came at the end of the runway, and I turned to go back to the hot stand, and the wind picked up my starboard wing, and I popped it back into the wind again, and I decided this is the place to stay, so I stayed there the rest of the time until the thunderstorm went away, heading into the wind. And with the thunderstorm back, I went back to the hard stands again. And there were planes upside down and everything all over the place. Really, they destroyed quite a few airplanes, you know. But somebody congratulated me on staying up there and not losing another airplane.
And this was a BT? The type of plane this was?
PT.
A PT.
Biplane, yeah. The old Stearman. Yes. Then we went to... I can't remember where I took base there, I'm sorry. We flew the old Volte Vibrator. And then we went to Advance. I flew the AT-9 at Advance because I was signed up to go for twin-engine fighter. And we flew the AT-9 and the AT-10.
Did you find, you know, you were getting into flying. Did you find it, you took to it, you had to, not that it came easy, but that you...
Yes, I did, yes. I love the AT-9. That's the plane of the... Only the B-26 had a higher wing loading than it did. In fact, after the war, according to the little write-up in the museum, there's a model of the AT-9. It was called the Curtis Jeep. And they destroyed them all after the war. They wouldn't let civilian pilots use them. But we had an interesting time there. I don't know how many of the other people flew the 9. I don't think there were that many. But we took a night navigation mission. And just as I was leaving, I was in the plane all alone. And one of the instructors said, "Hey, can I join you?" And I said, "Certainly, come on up, your boy." So we were flying, and we looked down, and there was a city down there. And he said, "Well, that's an interesting city." And I said, "Well, there's no city supposed to be there. Our flight plan did not take us over a city." And he said, "Well, what could it be?" I said, "It has to be Valdosta. It's the only city around here." So he said, back to the field, you know. So we went back to the field. And they found out that the weather, the wind direction and velocity that they came was almost 45 degrees off of what it really was. And we had planes all over southern Georgia. So other than that.
Well, so where did it go from? You had the 18-9s. Where did it go from there?
B-17s.
What was your impression of the B-17?
Wow. Now, I never took transition flight in the B-17. I was a co-pilot, and that's where I stayed. But it was interesting. I got promoted the same time the pilot did. And I remember we got stopped down at the flight line one time. This major came by and said, "You co-pilots, you never do a damn thing. You don't know anything about the airplane." So the pilot said, "Well, ask him some questions." So he asked me questions about takeoff and speeds and RPMs and so forth, and I answered every one of them. He shook his head and left. So I was serious about it. I used to go down there and sit in the cockpit and close my eyes and reach out and feel where all the buttons and switches were. I flew as much as he did, and I could fly as well as he did, although I hope he never hears me say that.
That's a good question, by the way. Who was your pilot?
Datz. Robert L. Datz, D-A-T-Z. So we went over on the Queen Elizabeth, and one of the fellas said, "You know, there's 7 times more people on this boat than there are in the town I came from."
Did it seem crowded?
Oh, yes. No question about it. But we had a little stateroom that there. I think there were three or four of us in it. And the bombardier, whose name was Bradbury, got seasick when the boat was still at the dock. He went to bed and stayed there until we got into England, you know. Five. We were supposed to make it in 5 days, but we went around a sub back, and we made it in 6 days.
What do you remember about that journey across all that water? And
oh, well, you know, I'm kind of used to water, and I thought it was a remarkable ship, although we couldn't do much. That was separated, and they kind of, we were become, you know, buck lieutenants at the time. They let us to walk around any way we wanted, but
we didn't
get out of there. But it was a fast trip, I guess, you know. It was a nice trip. It was better than coming home.
So you got over there. Did it land in Liverpool?
Yes.
So where did you go from there then?
Went to Framilingham by train.
When you got to the base, you know, for those who have never been there, what did it look like? I mean, what was it like living there?
Well, everybody else, I have to say, was quite friendly and welcomed us there. As far as all the facilities, they were strictly GI. And it was 1,000% better than it was in Nashville. It was as good as any of the others, you know.
Where did you live?
We lived in an Eason hut, and I can't. I was with the 568th Squadron. And the other pilot and I both shared the room all to our own, ourselves. And we had a coal or wood fire stove out in the middle of the floor. And so I'm a gadget man. I make more gadgets than you can imagine. So I made a gadget that we put my gadget in the bottom and put paper around it and put wood around it and coal around it. And when I woke up in the morning, all I had to do was grab a string and yank it, and it lit the fire. And it was a piece of sandpaper hooked up, pushing up against a little gadget made out of bent coat hangers, press it up against three matches all put together, and it lit the paper, and it lit the wood, and we had fire in about 15 minutes.
Do you remember the month and year you went over there?
It was on or about April.
44. Did the training continue even when you got over there?
Oh, yes, we had training missions many, many days that we did not fly combat.
And were they teaching you, what were they teaching you during that period over there then?
Well, we used to make simulated bomb runs on places, you know, and navigation ways around the area. We got too close to London one time, and shell went off about a quarter of a mile in front of us. The voice came on the radio and said, go away. but we did a lot of flying, even not combat flying. You
know. Were they teaching close formation flying?
No, I would say no. As I remember, most of it, what we did, we went up alone. Mm. Yes. Yeah. But we had simulated bomb runs on places, which we photographed and so forth. We had a good bombardier, very good bombardier. Unfortunately, he was such a good bombardier. His name was Bradbury. They made a lead bombardier out of him.
So you lost him.
He was the first trip he went out. The plane was blew up. Yeah. And then there was another problem. They held our mail for about 3 or 4 weeks before D-Day. So nobody at home, and you know, nobody. His wife didn't know that he wasn't flying with us. And so she naturally calls all the other wives to see what they hear. Now they hear that bombardier was missing in action or killed. So they've never heard from anybody else, you know, so. Mm. A short time later, they opened up the mail, so they suddenly received great globs of mail. We used to use the V-mail. You write it and gets photographed and sent across and unphotographed, so. Yeah.
Well, how many missions did you fly?
35. We finished our tour.
Do you remember the first mission?
Yeah, definitely.
What do you remember?
Berlin.
What a way
and
to start.
And they weren't flying with the crew. They needed a co-pilot on another ship, So I flew with them on the first mission, yes. And then...
What was it like flying to Berlin on your first mission?
Well, since even this pilot let me fly more than most of them, I was too busy looking at the other airplane. Oh, you could look out, their flak was something terrible, you know. I'm not that religious when it comes to specific religions, but there's been something in my life that's kept me going and kept me alive in so many instances that I, over 600 people died in that 38 hurricane, and I was out in the middle of it. I'm still here, you know. But I said, the good Lord, you make me live through this, and I'll go to church more often, was what I actually said. I didn't say I was going to be any better. But then we returned.
So you sort of attained that rite of passage in that first mission.
That's right.
Were you able to then get back to your own crew after that?
Yes. I flew tail gunner a couple of trips. A rated pilot always flew on the tail of the lead ship because the pilots can't see what's behind them. And I remember I don't remember where we went, but one of the groups was beginning to drift back farther, so I just called ahead. Other than that, it was a quiet mission, yeah.
You know, in those 35 missions, you're not going to remember all the missions, but there had to be memorable missions, missions that stood out in your mind. What are some of the missions you do recall?
We flew on two missions where we bombed so deep into Germany, we went into Russia. We landed in Mirgorod or Poltava, one or the other, you know. The first time we landed on this big, wide runway that they said had been bombed, so watch the craters. But the craters, luckily, were at the first leading edge and not at the end, you know. And we had an interesting thing. We flew a warm front. I don't know if you know much about warm fronts and cold fronts. Cold fronts are the mass of cold air moving. Warm fronts are this way, and the air goes up the front. And so we could see it was like looking at a flat cloud layer. And we flew up and up and up and up, followed, trying to come over the top of it, which we never made. So we spread out, everybody picked a heading and an altitude, and everybody kept at it, and we broke out of it, and nobody used to get hurt at all, you know, but that was interesting. Another interesting thing was two more things. We were sitting on the runway, parked, you're not ready to, not leaving, but getting ready to leave. And we had RDX in the bombs, which was fairly touchy. And the bombardiers were testing the opening and closing of the bomb bay doors. And unfortunately, the third plane from us, they had a salvo switch on. So as soon as the bomb bay doors opened all the way up, the whole bomb load dropped down on the runway. And being RDX, everybody was pretty worried about it, you know. And one of the crew fellas said, what are we going to do? I'm going to get out and get running. I said, if one of those goes off, they're all going to go off. Then you don't make any difference. If you're a quarter of a mile from here, you're not going to be around anymore.
You're all on the ground when this happens?
On the ground, yeah.
So those bombs are just laying on the ground under the plane?
Yeah. Now, the little safety propellers hadn't come off, but they pulled all the wires out.
So the bombs hadn't armed yet?
They were still armed. But being the type of, I've seen bombs go off in the air when they hit, two of them hit together in the air, you know. And this explosive was rather sensitive, you know. And of course, if one had gone off, they would have all gone off. And there would have been a 200-foot hole there and nothing else. 200-foot hole. But another thing was that when we first landed on the first time, Dad said, you know they're going to shut this base down. There's a little nice little town nearby, I think. Let's go see what we can find it or not. So we got out to the street, hitchhiked a road with a truck full of Russian soldiers. And so they took us into the town. I think it was Poltava, but I'm not sure. Could have been Mirgorod. So we wandered around town. We went into this house where they were showing movies and watched some Russian movies a while. We're just wandering around when this big fancy car drives up beside us, and this major comes out, a Russian major, and he was very nice. He was very nice, and he thought that would be best for everybody if we got in the car and went back to the base again. But he was very pleasant, so we were pleasant, so we went back to the base again. And, but nobody said a word about it, and nobody even mentioned it at all. No, maybe they didn't know it, but he did. We're always wanderers of the wasteland.
Did you get to see some of the Russian soldiers or interact at all? Or
no, not really.
Or see any of the Russian women soldiers?
Oh, the Russian women, not particularly soldiers, no. But we saw a lot of Russian women. In fact, they brought a truck up full of 250-pound bombs. Two Russian women picked them up and brought them over and put them down underneath the planes, and we dragged them up inside, you know. They were hefty girls. Very nice. Everybody was very pleasant. In the town, people used to come up and shake our hands and so forth. Everybody was very nice.
That mission, it landed in Russia. Where did it go from there?
We bombed the coast of Yugoslavia. We landed in Foggia, Italy. We landed on those nice steel interlocking plates. And we stayed there. I think we did one mission out of there, up into southern Germany. And then we bombed the port of Marseille on the way back to England again.
Let me ask you one question. What was it like in Foggia in Italy?
He was out in the boondocks. It was very nice because our radio operator, Friedman, was kind of and Rice, there were two of them. He was the engineer. They were kind of they were awful good guys, but they somehow ended up with a case of champagne they brought back to England. Yeah. It was great. It was great there.
So you went. You then ended up in Marseille, I think you said.
We bombed Marseille. Port of Marseille.
I see.
And then we flew back to England again. Yes. We did another interesting mission. We flew supplies to the Marquis, the Free French, down in central France. And then we got over 100, 200 feet off the ground. And we flew over the French countryside, and wings up over high trees and church steeples. And I remember we went right down through the middle of one little town. And, you know, it was you never saw people scatter like they said. I can't blame them, you know, with a big hunk of machinery flying about 200 feet off the ground or 300 feet off the ground. And we circled an area down there, and they had colored patches on the ground, big, perhaps 3 by 4 feet. And they were yellow and orange and red and so forth. And they set up a pattern, red, red, yellow, red, blue, red, and something. Well, I don't remember what the pattern was, but then we threw the things out. Some had parachutes, and some were just well packaged. And
could you see people on the ground?
Oh, sure. Well, I mean, it was close as the other side of the street, you know, they were that close, yeah. We flew over the ocean sea there, but I guess it's the southern part of the North Sea, you know. We were blowing the tops of the waves off.
And it was just keep below the radar?
Yes.
And
we flew individuals, about 3 minutes apart, 3 or 4 minutes apart, yes. Yeah.
Did you run into any flak or fighters on that?
Nothing, no flak, no fighters, no nothing. Nobody that I know of, some shot at us that we know of. You know, they might have after we went by, but no, very quiet.
That's certainly memorable, flying that low.
Oh, that's neat. I always like to fly low. In fact, when I was in cadets, I was accused. Somebody said that locals said this plane flew underneath the railroad tracks up the river, and he had my number on it. Now, I got hauled up before the CO, and I don't know whether he read a 3 as an 8 or whatever it was, because I did not fly underneath the railroad tracks. My motto then is the same as it is now. There are lots of old pilots and there are lots of bold pilots, but there are no old bold pilots. So I did not fly underneath the railroad track.
Did you do some of the flying on that mission to the Maquis? I mean, you.
Yes.
So you were.
We both flew.
How difficult is it flying that close to the ground? I mean,
you just watch ahead. You watch quite far ahead, and you can see the trees sticking up and the church steeples sticking up. You know, but we stayed pretty close to the ground. You know, we wanted to get there and get there. Our motto was: do the job and get home.
Were there any missions that you lost an engine?
Yes, we lost an engine. I don't remember where it was, but I remember we lost an engine. I'm sorry, I don't remember where it was. We came back one time and we were so low on fuel that we threw guns overseas, we threw the radio equipment overseas, we threw everything we could get a hold of overboard.
Why were you so low on fuel on that mission?
Who knows? I can't tell you. I do know one thing. The back of my chair and the pilot chair and the seat of them had half-inch plates of metal that the crew had put on. Now, I don't think that significantly changed much, but we did burn a little more fuel than some of them did, you know, careful on fuel. But that was the only real time that we came back and really so-called fumed, you know. Yeah.
Yeah. Were there missions where you were attacked by, I mean, talking, your plane was attacked by fighters?
Yes, many. What? One time we looked out and there was a whole row of FW-190s ahead of us, coming straight at us a couple of miles away. All the wings were popping yellow, you know, pop, bright things. And the engineer couldn't wear his steel helmet up between the guns. So he had a little flak helmet.
So he's
very
up,
small.
He's
very
up in
thin.
The top turret.
Yeah, the top turret. And he ducked down to pick up the helmet and he got a hit right on the turret.
Only his head wasn't in the turret at the time.
His head wasn't in the turret, right.
Did you ever, and you touched on this a little bit as far as religious aspects when you're up there on the plane and everything, did that kind of thing where timing was everything, where, you know, the luck of the draw, fate, whatever you want to call it, did you ever think about that?
Absolutely. If I had been, well, one mission we're on, we're about 30 seconds from bombs away, and I look up and there's an airplane directly about 20 feet above us with the bomb bay. You can look right up the bomb bays. Needless to say, in that 20 seconds we got out, it was probably 30 seconds, more than 20 seconds. But we moved.
Were there other missions that you recall, you know, fighters coming in and
many times. We had a rocket go through us once, which was the only time we'd ever had it. The rocket came up and went straight through the, well, it was a little distance away, but it left the vapor trail, smoke trail, all the way up until it quit, and then it circled around, supposedly to come back through us again. But we never saw a jet fighter, you know, anything like that. But we saw, you know, many. We had, I don't know, we must have had 1,000 holes in the plane. I've got a little box at home with pieces of shrapnel that I picked up on the floor and places like that, you know. It was active.
Was anyone in your crew ever injured?
No. We never shed a drop of blood on the airplane. Never. Except what I do with airplanes. I bomb my head. But no one ever got hit.
Were you in the, sort of as you went through your missions, were you doing a countdown? Were you keeping track of your missions?
I was definitely looking forward to number 35 because I don't know what the statistics are, but it just seemed. It could have been imagination. It could have been anything, but it seemed like from 30 up, we lost more planes than we did between 1 and 30. No, you know, that probably is strictly psychological because I couldn't prove it. But it just seemed like people who had only a few missions left never came back again, you know. Yeah.
How, you must have had, you know, seen other B-17s go down and the loss of other crews and that sort of thing. How do you handle that loss mentally? How do you keep going?
Well, the only thing you can say to yourself is, that's terrible, but it's not here. There's no other way to look at it. There's always a way to look at it, and if you do it, you can worry about it. 20 seconds from now, it could be me. And yet the time, you know, the time just never came. I mean, we had lots of flak, go airplane, it'd go whoomp, one flak went off underneath us, you know. And, we had a hit across the, it didn't cut the plane in half, but it had a big, I think it was a 20 millimeter blast, just ahead of the rudder, just ahead of the high place, high part of the rudder. And it did damage to the plane so that the tail gunner couldn't get out. It cut all our top control wires, but we have control wires underneath. So we landed very gently, hoping that the tail wouldn't fall off. But it didn't.
I think that's the thing that amazes people is how much damage those B-17s could take, and you could still get them on the ground.
Yeah. You could hear a blast go off overhead, and all of a sudden it sounded like it was hail, and you'd look out on the wings, and there's 30 little holes there that weren't there before, you know. And the planes up there, if you were flying fairly close underneath another airplane in another part of the formation, when they use their guns, they used to dump the 50 caliber shells overboard, and they'd hit the plane. They'd hit the propeller would take one and whack it off into the side of the airplane. I can just imagine. Well, I was in England when we got a big raid, and the handy aircraft went off. Lots. And so I went out there looking at the fellas. You better get out because all that stuff's coming back down again. And then it was just like raining hunks of iron all over the place because all that stuff that blows up in the air eventually gets back down to the ground again, you know. But
what was the 35th mission like?
All I remember, when we came in, they actually got a whole box of flares, and we flew about 30 feet off, well, maybe more than that, 50 feet off the ground out in front of the control tower, sending off flares, all but red. And we must have sent off about 8 or 10 of them. Then we swooped around and landed, and that was our last mission. I don't remember where it was, but I remember shooting the flares off.
How long then was it before you went home?
It must have been about September, somewhere in that vicinity, September or October. Yes, I went home and had a 10-day leave. And got the redistribution in Atlantic City, actually. We spent a week down there and we're waiting for reassignment. And the word was we're going to go to Japan. And I have a flight surgeon to thank, because he said, and it was, I was the only one there. The crew had already gone home. I stayed there a while and flew the radar ships from their home base to where they were going to be used the next day. And then when they came back from the mission, they dropped them off at that base for service. But he said, no man that flew 35 missions over there is going to go to Japan, I can tell you. So he was my buddy, my lifelong buddy, you know.
So where did it go from there then?
Went down to, had my 10 days off and got married. No, I didn't either. I got married before I went overseas. Had a honeymoon, I should say. And went down to Tampa, Florida and met the fellas of the 17th group.
And so how did you spend the rest of the war then? I mean, Japan, you know, what was it, August of 45, I guess the war was over in Japan. Where were you at that point?
I was here. When I got back from overseas, I got redistribution to Marana Air Force Base up here between Tucson and Phoenix. I was a flight instructor for about 4 or 5, maybe 6 months. I only had about 5 classes, I guess. And so we were right here, and I had an interesting, I, uh, I taught basic, which was a lot of aerobatics and stuff like that, and some navigation, but ability to control the airplane, basically. And I used to get airsick.
You used to get airsick?
Yeah. Never got it before. So they wanted a flight instrument instructor, so I said, I'll go. So I went down to Randolph Field in Texas for about 2 or 3 weeks and took an instrument instructor's course. And it was interesting down there. They had a big medical group, I guess, in Randolph. And they were developing an anti-airsick pill, or anti-seasick pill. So I went to get actual physical instruction in the morning. In the afternoon, they gave me a pill and told me to take the plane up and rack it out and see if I could make myself airsick. And then come back down and fill out a form. Did it good? Was it bad? And so forth. And so I did that for about a week or 10 days. You know, and some of the pills were great and some of the pills weren't and so forth, you know.
But well, when did you get out of the service then?
Well, after that, they closed Marana. So I went to Barksdale Field outside of Shreveport, Louisiana, and flight line maintenance on B-29s. And I wasn't there too long. I can't remember the date it was, but I don't think I was there for 2 months. And the CO there said all rated pilots are going to get checked out in the B-29. We were on maintenance, so alphabetically, he said. So by the time they hit the G's, which is just before the H's, some colonel came by, and they did this quite frequently. We had an AT-6 there that we used to use, and he wanted to fly to somewhere, Miami or something like that, so I took him there. And when I got back there, and the I's and the J's, I didn't want to get checked out on the B-29. That happened twice. Two times I managed to be elsewhere. And the third time he called me personally and said, you better be on the line, but I was discharged before that. So that took care of that, you know. And beside that, I said, you know, I don't have a four-engine MOS anymore. I had just single and twin. He said, I can take care of that. And about 2 days later, I got a little note informing me that my four-engine MOS had been reinstated. Anyway, so I got discharged down there.
What was your occupation after the war then?
Well, three of my buddies went with American Airlines, and my wife and I discussed it, and we discussed that I was going to take 4 years of college, which I did. I went to Brown University for 4 years. And when I was in Providence, I was in the reserve. I got promoted to captain in the reserve. And then I got transferred to Bangor, Maine after quite a while. And in Bangor, Maine, even though there was no Air Force base there, they wouldn't let me fly anything. So I joined a group that keeps track of aircraft, and I can't remember the name of the group. We had a big round circular board where people stand behind it and write backwards, and we got telephones, wireless, every kind of information from other airplanes where everybody was flying. And we tracked them all, mostly coming across the ocean, from behind this big, big circular plexiglass board that we all wrote backwards on. And I did that for a while, and then they decided, no, that was not very qualifying. So they said, you're going to resign. I said, I don't want to resign. Well, they said, you resign or we'll demote you or something. So I resigned, and that was the end of my military career.
And then what kind of work did you do after the service?
I went to work for IBM, which meant I'm being moved.
And how many years did you work for IBM?
Well, I studied IBM. First I went to 4 years at Brown University. And I got out in Brown University at 49. And I got, they were kind of overloaded and trying to get rid of people. So about 1975 or 78, somewhere in there, I took early retirement, which was nice because they paid me my retirement plus half salary for 4 years. And So I retired on a Friday, and I came home and got my trailer on a Monday, and Ma and I took off and didn't come back for a month and a half.
You know, at the age you are now, do you ever look back on those years in England?
Yes.
Yeah, what do you think about now? What pops in your mind when you think back on that time?
Well, I've been to England twice as a tourist. We bought a Volkswagen Vanagon with a group in Wiedenburg, Germany. And we wandered around 22 countries of Europe and Tangiers and Morocco for 6 months and then came home again. And then that was 83. In 1987, my wife went over and rented a motor home, and we just stayed in England, Scotland, and Wales for 6 weeks, you know. So, but the comparison between them is very interesting, you know. It's just, physically, they hadn't changed much. I mean, like, if you went over there now, you wouldn't see much change either. But we always had great luck with the English people. My background is English and Scotch, and it was very enjoyable. I enjoyed England. I visited when I was based over there. We only got in England twice. I mean, in London twice. And the third time that we went out, my wife's mother's sister lived in Hanley Stoke-on-Trent up near Birmingham. So we went up and visited them. I went up and visited them. And that was interesting because the V-2s or V-1s were flying around, you know, and you'd be sitting at the table and you'd hear them coming up. You know, rah, 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 and everybody would stop doing it. And they would go, rah, 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 and then they would go back again. And one time it, rah, 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 and it stopped, and everybody just sits there and waits. Where is it going to go off, you know? And those people, I just don't know. If that happened in the United States, we'd have masses of people screeching and howling and running all over the place, you know? They just took the war. I suppose they've had other times, you know. Get used, so-called used to it over the centuries or whatever you have, yeah. But they were a great people. Yeah.
When you look back on your time in service, were you proud of your time in service?
Yes.
Why?
Well, I thought we had a job to do. I thought we had the help that we needed to do the job. And I had a couple of bitches in service, but everybody does. But I don't know. I think it was I hate to say it, exciting, even though you're about getting killed, you know. But I've always been, I've been shot at other than that, and I've been on wandering around during hurricanes and lost in places and things like that. And I look back at it with not hoping they'd do it again, but I have no regrets.